Welcome. So I'm Dan Cook. I work over at ScotLogic, which is literally just over the road from here, so from Bristol. We've got a stand here, so if you want to have a chat to the guys at ScotLogic about other things we get up to, that'd be great. And I want to talk about Kafka and Spark today, and the thing that didn't make it on to this slide as well is a little bit of Flink as well. So I've sort of been in the big data space for the past few years now. Sort of last year, I was architecting Hadoop as a service offering for a government department to ingest, catalog, and give them a query capability on top of their maritime geospatial data. And towards the tail end of the year, I was working on a cyber threat detection platform using Kafka and Spark, taking in things such as NetFlow data, so sort of bytes transmitted, received, source IP, destination IP, port. And that was quite high volume, quite high throughput. It was sort of in the regions of hundreds of thousands. We were doing about 150,000 events per second on 10 VMs. And we were doing things in real time, like detecting port scanning for that approach. I sort of wanted to give this talk to sort of show that big data's also it's not just a buzzword. Maybe you'll leave the talk feeling that it still is. But a lot of the tech that's out there for big data, you can apply it for real world problems and it can solve those really well. You don't need high volume, you don't need high throughput. There's some good concepts in there that can really work for you. So that's how I got into big data. I didn't set out with the desire necessarily to get into the big data space. I used to be an embedded C++ engineer, and I realized that everyone else was growing beards or already had beards, and I couldn't grow that great facial hair, so I thought I didn't fit in here. So after a chance encounter with one of my bosses, I managed to wangle my way onto a Java project. I sort of arrived on that in 2011. I couldn't really write a line of Java. Everyone kept telling me I was putting my braces in the wrong place and things like that. And when I finally left that project, I was the technical lead of the framework that we built there, and lots of other projects were built on that framework. And what we had was a problem where we had lots of incoming records arriving, and we had to validate those records. We had to analyze them, augment them in particular ways, drop them if they were out of bounds, and then supply them downstream. And this was all at scale. So the existing system in place could handle tens of thousands of records per hour. It was built on a relational database. And we needed to do millions. So we built a new framework to do this. So this is in 2011, the same year that Apache Storm got open sourced. We pretty much built it ourselves. We were, you know, not that clued up on what else was out there. And we did things like denormalizing our database schema using NoSQL databases, partitioning our processing. So lots of processors processing different parts of the data. In order to supply those processors, we had lots of separate message queues. And we'd route data to different message queues depending on what downstream process was gonna handle that. You know, and we did that in order to scale. And we had to handle things such as idempotency. So all our active MQ, our queues were back to disk. If things fell over and came back up, they'd potentially resupply the same messages to our downstream systems. So we had to handle duplicates. And it worked great. You know, we built quite a lot of projects on the back of that. It wasn't without its flaws, though. It was a bespoke framework. Everyone that came onto the project had obviously never heard of it. They had to learn it. It felt like there were other tools and other technologies out there that could do this sort of thing, and indeed there were. The year we started was the year Apache Storm, the streaming technology, came out, or got open source, should I say. We also had problems with our framework, our limiting factor. So we could do millions of records per hour, but our limiting factor actually became object allocation on the JVM. Every time we received a message, we allocated an object for that. We didn't pool them in any way, and when GC, garbage collect, sort of kicked in, we had big pauses. And also managing an estate of processors across VMs, you know, we just sort of did millions per hour on 10 VMs, but you know, when you span across VMs, you've got to find a way to manage those processors, and we were struggling with that. Before I go into the streaming tech, I want to talk about imperfect representations. I want to talk about the fact that we often forget, or I quite often forget, that what we build is a poor analogy for the real world. It's an approximation to what we really want. We've really developed agile methodologies and Scrum to sort of ask, what does the user want? What does the user need? And then all of a sudden we go, oh, we'll do that relational database. Relational databases are great, but we've got to look at what are the limitations of the tech that we're using. You know, what is it? Does that hinder our use case in any way? Is it actually stopping the user getting what they really want? So we need to be looking at what else is out there. What other tech are the better ways of doing things? Is different tech better for particular problems? So this is the use case that I want to run with for the rest of this presentation. So this is the use case I'm going to use, an air pollution monitoring use case. So imagine you've got an array of sensors out in the field, all monitoring air pollution in some fictional unit. And then you're supplying that data to a set of ingest processors that, you know, are translating it to some normalized form, maybe filtering readings that are really, really excessive, you know, that are completely out of bounds, doing whatever. Ultimately, putting those readings in a relational database in a table. So, you know, imagine sort of rows of timestamp and reading. And then at some point in the future, a periodic query runs and it goes through that table and, you know, it sort of averages those pollution readings and detects if the pollution for particular areas has gone above certain limits, and you potentially raise alerts to our happy user off the back of that. So I wanted to show some SQL. I don't write much SQL these days. But this is I want to show the evolution of this query through the different technologies. So we've got this this single table, sensor readings, that there you go, to the table, and we're going to group on time bucket. Imagine we've got some sort of user-defined function that takes a timestamp and say puts readings in. My cat loves this laser pen. It's multi-purpose. can be used at presentations. And we're going to group these readings into time buckets and then do an average for each time bucket. And if the pollution for that time bucket is above a certain bound, then we're going to return those from this query. Our application code will see all these bad pollution readings and we'll do whatever. We'll call our REST API, we'll, you know, send SMSs, do whatever we need to, stick it on a billboard, say the pollution's bad. So that's the general format of this use case. But what's wrong with this? The fact that periodically this query runs, you know, it may be every 4 hours. You know, what if someone wants to know that the pollution was bad now, at this moment, don't go into this area in the city? You know, they've got to wait 4 hours to find that out. You know, you could make it the batch period a bit shorter, but still, it's not going to be in real time or near real time. Also, what happens if you've got sort of IoT proportions of data? You know, a hell of a lot of sensors, hundreds of thousands of events per second. Sure, you can scale pretty well with a relational database. You know, you get up to hundreds of thousands per hour, but not per second. You're going to be able to go into the terabytes region, lower terabytes probably, but not hundreds, not petabytes. So it's not going to scale to the problems that we're seeing in the IoT world. I sort of want to go back a step and talk about Apache Hadoop, the elephant. So for me, the thing that is really key about Hadoop, the concept that I take away is the unified API. I think of it as a unified API. So I can't believe, you know, when I looked this up, maybe I've got it wrong, but it was in 2003 that the Google File System paper came out, which was the origins of the Hadoop file system. This idea of a distributed store across an array of machines, across an array of disks, but with an API to the user that it seemed like you were accessing one hard disk. And if you lost a node in the cluster, you wouldn't lose your data. Then you're great. It's handling a distributed framework for you. A year or two later, the MapReduce paper came out, and it was the same thing again. It was a unified API for processing. So you could write your program, and that program would look the same, the API looks the same, regardless if you run against one machine or hundreds of machines. Quite a lot of my friends like saying, and I like saying this, the world doesn't need more programming languages. Or maybe that needs a little bit more clarification. I quite often see that people throwing out programming language and saying it's got great new concurrency constructs. And it's like, but hey, you're still running on one machine. What you want is constructs that run across machines and are simple to use. And that's what the Hadoop APIs are all about. You know, that is the language that we need for distributed processing. And there's also other great ideas in that space, such as, you know, I spoke about an array of disks with your data on for HDFS. And it's that whole idea of partitioning, chunking your problem up into smaller portions that you can then distribute, whether you do that with data or processing. Also, when you do have processing to do, trying to co-locate it with the data that you have, so you're not shipping large volumes of data over a network link. And we know that network links are going to be slower than disk. So going to the technologies on that are in the talk title, so thinking about Kafka, I've spent years managing lots of separate ActiveMQ instances. And to achieve things like scaling, I've ended up manually partitioning my problem and sort of saying if data is destined for this downstream process, put it on this queue or put it on that queue, potentially on a different broker. It always felt to me like clustering wasn't a first-class citizen like it should have been with a messaging broker solution like ActiveMQ. Similarly, I've always had big headaches when I've gone, well, if this broker fails, I want another broker to take over in its place and start serving data, the same data that was on that queue on the other broker. And those sort of failover strategies aren't that easy to achieve with most traditional brokers that are out there. So this is what Kafka is to me. Kafka is this, you know, this great system where clustering is a first-class citizen out of the box. It's quite easy to spin up multiple nodes on different VMs and have them all work together as a cluster. So Kafka takes this idea of a topic, so a queue in AMQP or JMS speak, and it partitions that topic into separate chunks. And it will locate those partitions on different brokers if you have many brokers in your cluster. You're already starting to get a feel how this could scale. And it manages that for you. For your producers and consumers, they don't necessarily care that there's many partitions to this topic. It gets sort of load balanced for you. Also, those partitions are replicated by a factor of your choosing. And they'll be replicated onto different brokers. So if you lose one broker in your cluster, you know that partition is somewhere else ready for another consumer to pick up from the brokers that are still running. You don't lose your data. And also one of the things that, you know, sort of comes out of the Hadoop space, comes out of that big data processing sort of ideas, is an append-only model. So spinning disks are notoriously slow at random access. It's always easier to just write where you currently are. So Kafka adopts that append-only model, and it only ever puts new messages on the end of each partition. So what consumers do is they maintain an offset of where they are in each partition, and they update that as they read the messages. And Kafka actually ages off old data rather than trying to do some weird scan up and down the queue trying to figure out what was actually consumed. So where does this fit in the use case that I'm talking about? So imagine your array of sensors all right there, their data straight. You've got some lightweight processors running alongside them or actually on the sensor hardware, and they write that data into Kafka. You've got it onto a resilient store where you're not going to lose that data, and you know Kafka can scale, so it can take the load of all the sensors in your network right into that messaging broker. So we've spoken now about where the sensor data is going to go, but what about the processing? So Apache Spark, for me, the origins are rooted in MapReduce being great. And people sort of talk about Spark and then want to discard MapReduce, but the principles behind MapReduce are, you know, one of the reasons that Spark is great. So I'm not going to give a word count example for MapReduce, but the way I like to explain MapReduce is in SQL, if you were going to do a select star from a table, you'd achieve that with a map. If you wanted to join two tables in SQL, you could do that with a map and a reduce. You'd have two maps going over each table, omitting the rows in each table with the common join key, and then in the reduce phase, you look for those common keys and join the two rows from each table together. But to do anything useful in MapReduce, quite often you need multiple map reduce phases that are all chained together, such as joining with one table, followed by joining with another table. So the problem with the old MapReduce execution engine is it writes its intermediate results to disk. So it does the first MapReduce phase, sticks it on disk, and the second MapReduce phase has to read that data from disk. Disk is slow. Spark does one better and stores the intermediate results in RAM. So you can see how it's going to be much quicker. So it's great for batch iterative algorithms. And it's got a great machine learning algorithm library on top. So you can do some great stuff there. It's got graph processing. I know there's a lot of graph database talks today, but you can do graph processing in Spark. And it's got streaming. So we've got this Kafka set up with all of our data partitions in our topic. If we could spin up a process in Spark per partition, we've got something that scales and scales linearly. If we want things to go faster, we can add more partitions to our Kafka topic and we'll get more Spark processes. But one of the key things for me is Spark's got an API, as most of these tools have, that it doesn't care if it's running on one machine with, you know, one Kafka topic, a topic with one partition, or if that topic has many. The API still looks the same. So I wanted to write something in Scala. Just imagine it's Java, it's fine. Any bit you don't understand, just pseudocode. Imagine it's pseudocode. But the key thing here is we're setting up a streaming context in Spark with a micro batch duration of 10 seconds. So we're going to do 10 second windows. We're going to basically take all the data that arrives in 10 seconds, and then we're going to process it in some way. And this is where the core of the processing is. So this bit here is us processing the data in that 10 second window. So let's ignore the horrible Scala stuff and then go to this bit here, which is what we're really doing. So imagine our data is CSV delimiter, it's just comma separated. And it's timestamp and a pollution level. We're gonna split on the comma, and then we're gonna put it into this measurement record, which has just got a timestamp followed by a pollution reading. We're gonna convert to a data frame, which is sort of takes you into the Spark SQL, the SQL view of the world in Spark. And then we're gonna average that data. So we're going to average the pollution readings, basically calculate a mean, put an alias there, and then if that mean was greater than a set value, then we'll call our custom sync, you know, do our output function, you know, raise an alert, call our REST API, do whatever. But the key thing here is this isn't running every 4 hours. this is waiting for new data to arrive, and data in that 10-second window, it's going to process it and raise an alert pretty much as it happens, right? That's an improvement. That's great. So I just wanted to talk a little bit more about Kafka and Spark and the interaction and maintaining where you are reading from the partitions. So if your Spark app falls over and comes back up, you want it to resume reading from where you were up to, right? And this is all this bit of code is doing here. It's basically saying, so this elided bit is the processing you saw on the previous slide. And then after that, you're basically going to do a commit back to Kafka at the end and say, I processed all of those records, update the offset to the latest value. And that offset is stored in Kafka, and it's actually stored in a topic, so it's replicated, and you're not going to lose where your application was up to. I also wanted to briefly mention about why Spark micro batches. And it's to ensure exactly once. It will always, for a 10-second window of data, it will always calculate the correct mean, even in the face of failures. So on that previous slide that we were looking at, let's hop back, we were doing an average. What Spark is doing under the hood there is it's telling every process that's running for that particular topic that you subscribe to in Kafka, it's saying actually go through all the records in the partition you're processing and calculate a total sum of those pollution readings and a total count. And then, you know, once all the partitions have calculated their results, or as they've calculated their results, they actually send their total sum and their total count back to a central point. So you might have 10 partitions in our Kafka topic, and those 10 total sums and total counts all come back to a central point, and, you know, we add all the total sums together and we divide by the total count, and it gives us our mean. If any one of those processes crashes, you know, processing for a particular partition, Spark will ask it to recompute the value, and it'll always make sure that it never double counts a partition's results. You know, it might get emitted back twice to the central point, but it'll make sure that it always gives you the true mean, and no message runs through the framework twice and actually affects the count detrimentally. So there's a little pitfall here that I want to talk about is, maybe you've got your total result here and you've actually called your REST API and said, this is the result, the pollution's bad. If you fall over before you've committed your offsets, you may come back up and redo the calculation and call your external system again and say, the pollution's bad. It'll still have the same result as before, but it's going to be a duplicate. And it's just one of these pitfalls with these frameworks that while the framework will always guarantee the correct result and exactly once, as soon as you talk to external systems, all bets are off. You need to put some idempotency in there to make sure things work correctly, or that your end system doesn't care about being called with duplicates. So this is Cloudera Manager. I wanted to put this on here. I could have put Ambari on for Hortonworks, but I wanted to put it on because tools like Kafka and Spark, they integrate with the rest of the Hadoop ecosystem, which is great. So Cloudera Manager is a great tool to take some bare-bone Linux VMs that are just running DHCP, running NTP, just a few core services, and you can point this GUI at that node and say, put Kafka on there for me, please. Put Yarn. So Yarn is a platform as a service, in effect. It's sort of to the Hadoop world what Kubernetes or Cloud Foundry is to the microservice world. And Spark will run its cluster on Yarn. It's one of the ways you can do it. But you can set up a node to take Yarn, take Kafka, really easily, because you don't want to manage a cluster yourself. That's hard work. Also, one of the things it does is, once things are running, you get all of these metrics to see that things are running okay. If something falls over, you get a nice red dot, and you can restart that. It's a great sort of DevOps tool. Also, you might want to spin up something like HBase, which, you know, crudely speaking, is a key value store to store the results of your streaming framework. So I've not spoken about numbers yet. So you can't really see the axes on the graph and the numbers on the axes. But the key takeaway, so this is a benchmark which you can obviously go and have a look at. It's done by the Yahoo guys. I've done something similar a few months ago with Catherine Spark, so I'll quite happily vouch for these numbers. These are across 10 VMs, sort of your average price car, 16 cores, 24 gig of RAM, you know, stuff you'd normally find in a data center. But the key thing is, we, in a, you know, a representative, a real world use case, we can process 170,000 events per second across 10 worker nodes of Spark. I think it was 5 additional Kafka nodes here. That's a big number, right? The framework I built in 2011 could only do probably 5,000 events per second across 10 nodes. These could do an order of magnitude like greater than that. Hey, it's a hell of a lot faster. So this line here, the one going up, worryingly, is Spark. There's some other streaming frameworks on here. We've got Storm and Flink down at the bottom. I'm not really going to talk about Storm today. It doesn't quite give you the same guarantees as Spark in the context of what I'm talking about. But I am going to talk a little bit about Flink. So what is this thing that's going up horribly? It is latency. So because of micro batches, throughput is not independent of latency. So when I say latency, I mean the time I was expecting a result, i.e. when a window closed, versus the time I actually got that result. So what we're finding is, to go faster or get higher and higher throughput in Spark, we actually have to increase the window size. We have to increase the micro batch duration to achieve that. Which, if we want near real time or real time alerts, if we want to find out when the pollution went bad as opposed to 10 seconds after it went bad, you can't quite do that with Spark. And as I said before, micro batches are really about achieving exactly once and fundamentally how the framework's built. Event time. So I've been speaking a lot about windows, and I've probably been misleading a little bit. Spark doesn't process things prior to 2.0, process things based on the time that events actually originated. It basically processes events when they arrive, or almost like that. So it's going to go, what data has arrived in the past 10 seconds? Great, I'll calculate my result. But what if some of your sensors went offline? What if they, while they were offline, they buffered data, but the rest stayed up? And then the ones that were offline came back up and started sending their buffered data. This old data arrived at the same time at Spark as new data. And then we calculate our pollution average. And it's not right. It's not actually for that time window. So what have people done to solve this prior to sort of last year or so? You can build it yourself. You can start maintaining state across micro batches in Spark. But that's complicated. It gives you a bit of a headache. And then you get even poorer latency, and we don't want that. Also, there's been this whole drive towards Lambda architectures, which are criminal. I think absolutely criminal. This whole idea that you'll have a streaming framework that gives you approximate values, but then you'll put it in a resilient store, and at the end of the day, you'll calculate a batch report to give you the real numbers. Hey, just go back to your relational database. We're just going back to the model that we knew. Something evidently isn't right. This whole dependence on window size, batch duration, and latency, not being able to process things based on the time they originated. Spark is a great framework. I think it's a great framework. It works really well for batch problems, for things stored in HDFS. It's got some great machine learning libraries. It does streaming ETL really well, integrates with the rest of the ecosystem. But microbatching isn't time windows, it's a processing construct. Remember at the start I spoke about imperfect representations. Are we just getting back to the same point? We've gone down a path because it worked great and we've started to apply it to different problems and it's not quite working. You know, just as a relational database is forever limited by one box, our micro batches actually causing us the problem in the streaming world. So this is a simplified example of what things could be. So imagine these are our pollution readings. So a pollution of 70, 90, and then this mysterious checkpoint record. I've simplified the example, but imagine this is our aggregate, operator that's calculating our intermediate state, our total sum and total count, you know, that we're eventually just going to divide and give us the result. And then imagine that R70 flows through our operator. We store the total sum and the total count in there. Right, nice and simple. And then our 19 goes through. So we go up to 160, 90 plus 70, and the total count goes to 2. Off we go, our intermediate state's getting updated. But imagine just in front of Kafka, we've now received this checkpoint record. And what we do is go, the stream is at this particular position now, so we put that in some storage. And then the checkpoint goes through the aggregate operator. And the intermediate state of the aggregate operator when the checkpoint hit it was 160 and 2. So we put that into our store. And imagine that checkpoint goes all the way through our pipeline, through all the operators, and we keep augmenting this with each intermediate state. And then we hit the final operator in our pipeline and we're done. And we basically commit this and say that the pipeline for at this particular point was the state was all of these things. If we fall over and we reset the stream back to this position and this store here back to this, we're basically at this point here and we can carry on. You know, not missed any records. You know, it gives you that exactly once. It resets the stream back to where you were at that point and the state of everything else in the pipeline. So it's a different way of doing things. The key thing here is not to act on every tuple, every record that arrives. It's to put in the stream, you know, every few seconds a checkpoint record. It gives you something that can scale a lot more than, say, acting every tuple, which is what Apache Storm in its native form does. Never trust a benchmark without running it yourself, and I committed the cardinal sin of putting up a benchmark that I've not run. But the key thing for me going forwards is, I was talking about Kafka and Spark because that's my production experience, but this is where I'm looking currently, because this is the same benchmark as I was showing previously. Someone looked at that and went, hey, Flink can go so much faster than this. So they ran pretty much a similar setup, but when, how much throughput can we get through this? And doing the same use case, they showed around 3 million events per second. So 2011, I was doing 5,000. Then last year, 150,000. And now we're saying potentially we can go up again into the millions to process if we drop micro batches and we go to a slightly different view of the world. So that's what Apache Flink does, which is a new emerging technology. It's been around, I don't know, 2 or 3 years, I think. I've not used it in production yet, but you know, things look very promising. And one of the other things that looks really promising to me is this whole thing here. So it's got the same concepts as Google Cloud Dataflow, but it processes things based on event time. So it will bucket stuff into Windows for you. You don't have to do it yourself. And we know from one of the slides I showed previously that it can get down to low latency. So we're reading from Kafka again, processing multiple partitions. And it's on my GitHub, this link in the bottom right-hand corner if you want to take a closer look. But we're setting up a 2-second delay watermark here. There's a little bit of code behind that, but what it in effect means is I'm saying that once you see a sensor reading that's 2 seconds after a window should have closed, you know, 12 seconds in 10-second window case, then you can emit the result of that window and consider it complete. So you're going to have like probably a 2-second latency here at least. But the key thing is it's taking the timestamps out of the sensor readings to determine what the event time is and process things correspondingly. This is the code to calculate the mean. It is horrible. I was writing this and I went, oh, cringe. I can't just do some SQL. I hate SQL, but actually, when I wrote this, I love SQL. I don't know why I ever hated it. All this is doing is calculating a mean. So I've got some state here, my accumulator tuple, really. I'm going to output at the end of window end time a mean and a total sum. And basically, for every record as it arrives for that window, I'm I'm just basically summing the current pollution count in that record to the accumulated sum so far. And I think I've lost a one there. All right, it's in blue, I can't see it. And adding a one onto the total count. And then once this 2 second delay watermark thing triggers, then I'll actually output the calculation at the end. And this is the function that gets called. I'll basically just divide the total sum divided by the total count and output that. And again, if it's above a certain value, then I'll raise an alert, which is great. So Flink's not as integrated with the rest of the ecosystem yet. So when I wrote these slides, you still say couldn't deploy it with Cloud Era Manager. If you went out there recruiting for a Flink engineer, you probably wouldn't find any. People want SQL. It's table API, which is SQL-like operators. It's a work in progress, and it's getting there. But as you saw, I couldn't find just an average in there, which upset me. Spark's clued on to the fact that people want to do event time processing. So they have a structured streaming API, which is in alpha. So you can do this event time stuff now, and it will bucket things for you. I haven't looked at it yet, but time will tell if that can ever compete on latency. It feels to me like they're still trying to do the micro batch view of the world. So if you want to get down into the second sub-second processing, you may be struggling. But I think one of the key take-homes for me is Kafka and Spark, or Kafka and Flink, can really scale to processing IoT scales of data. But not just that. If you've got a real-time alerting use case, you don't need to use a relational database. You can use these tools to give you that functionality, and you can deploy them on one box if you wanted to. And one thing that hasn't been fixed yet is the storing of results. These tools are great at calculating the results, but then you have to say put your results in an external key value store to then look them up. There's sort of moves going on to try and absorb that into the frameworks and provide a query capability on top. And since we're at the watersheds, I know it's not in italics. I was going to put it in Comic Sans, but I didn't want to offend everyone. So, questions? I'll try my best to answer. I think there's a mic on its way, yeah.
They're probably going to record my...
Thank you. My question is, looks like your benchmarks you were showing, were they mostly for Scala tools, or...?
So the benchmarks, I can't remember now what they were written in, but I did a very similar benchmark with Kafka and Spark.
I mean, like
using
the
Java.
The libraries that are being tested, were they all Scala libraries?
It depends. So Spark is in Scala. Kafka is in Scala. But quite interestingly enough, I believe when I was writing the slides and doing the demos, I think the Kafka guys have deprecated all of their Scala APIs because I think they've got sick of cross-compiling. But I don't know what that means for their code. But interestingly enough, Flink is actually in Java. So I gave the example with a Scala code example. But the core library is in Java.
I was wondering, I'm a bit of a heretic. If people drawn comparisons with like Rust and D and those kind of languages, or
no, I've not looked at that. Okay. I'm afraid, so I won't try and make up an answer.
Okay, thank you.
Who's to say when the event time is? If you've got IoT all around the world, how does that actually work? Is there like a presuming there's a global clock or some magic happens, how do you know?
So with the event time, what you do in the Flink world is you actually write a function that, given your input records, will tell you what time it is. So, you know, I did something quite crude. If you go on my GitHub, it's just, I've got a generator that's just like, dump it in, timestamps and values. So typically, I would imagine, you know, over the years, most input sources I've dealt with will have a timestamp on there, and then it's just a case of writing a function to get that off those. But, you know, if things are in, you know, crazy formats, as long as you know, you can write a function to determine what you need to do to the data to get the timestamp you need, you can do that in those frameworks.
So in the situation where you were sort of bringing stream of data in, and you mentioned that maybe a sensor would go offline, yep, and would potentially batch up and then feed the data later, is it the case that if that goes beyond the window at which the average has been sort of calculated already, you would kind of discard that data, or do you kind of wait for it, or what? I mean, I guess it depends on the domain, but if it was important that you had all of the data, you've got a potentially variable latency of getting your average calculation coming out. Is that, have you handled that kind of situation?
So the answer is it's configurable. So you're always in a battle where if you set it too high, right, you've got to maintain all of that state, and then in an IoT level use case, you might be hanging on to a lot of data. But I think on the flip side of that is, you normally, as I've shown, you're maintaining a running count. You're not maintaining all the records. You're okay to do that. In Flink, you get a choice. You basically define a strategy, and from what I see, I don't think Spark, the new structured stream API, is quite there yet. But in Flink, you can basically say the normal window end time is 2 seconds after you've seen the last record, you know, the 10-second record for the window. I want you to emit the result then. But actually, it has an additional setting that you can basically say, if you get late records, discard them, or you can actually say, keep them for this length of time. So you basically get a watermark, and then there's a further setting that say, we'll keep it open 4 hours, and it will emit the result a second time. And if you're going to a key value store, it'll go over the top of it and put the new accurate value in. So yeah, you get a bit of flexibility. It isn't, you know, you can get your 2 second latency with an update in the future.
Cool, thanks.
I would be curious to know if you have evaluated for this kind of problem also Kafka streams. I never used it, but looks very promising for this kind of problem, and operationally makes things much easier. You don't have to deploy anything out of Kafka.
Yeah, I must admit, I need to have a look at that one. I think one of the great things in the world of big data, just as like the previous talk with JavaScript, is there's so many frameworks and technologies out there. I'm already in enough trouble with my wife trying to sort of do this in my free time as it is. But yeah, it's certainly on my to-do list to have a look at that. And I think I've presented a very narrow view of... So I'm traditionally from environments where we have to deploy things on-premise. So I always like deploying things onto data centers that you manage. But deploying to a cluster is hard, right? Even with the management tools that make it easy, you've got a level of complexity that you don't have with, you know, the days where you used to just run on one VM. And I think, you know, the cloud, there's a lot of cloud offerings out there, and by all means, you know, look for someone that manages it for you if you can, and you don't have data that your customers aren't happy in the cloud. So I'd certainly be pro tools that do some of this stuff. But, you know, I just like making things hard. That's why we built Storm ourselves. Great. Thank you very much for your time.